Welcome. I'm Peter Zimroth. I am the director of the Center on Civil Justice. We have a very exciting day ahead of us today. Before saying a word about the conference in the center, I want to thank some very important people who made this conference possible. Anyone who's put together a conference like this knows how difficult it is and how much work it is. And so I want to thank, and David Siffer, who's sitting over here, is our new research coordinator. And Shirley Dang, where's Shirley? Shirley is back there. You know, both of them came on board actually in October, only about 6 weeks ago, right when this was sort of beginning to gel. And so they've done a fantastic job. And they are the people who are most responsible for getting us here all in one piece. So thank you. And then the faculty co-directors who, I see Sam is here, and I know the others will be here later, Jeff Miller and Arthur Miller, and I want to say a word about them. They embraced this project from the very beginning, and indeed not just this project, but all the work of the center. And on that score, to my left is Troy McKenzie, who was one of the founding faculty directors, who's been on leave and is coming back, and I hope will come back to the center as one of the faculty co-directors. So that's a direct ask. also to thank during the course of the conference, you will see many of the of our advisory board members. It's a very, very impressive group of people. You should introduce yourself to them. And I won't. Do they have identification on their tag?
I think only the panelists do.
Only the panelists. But so I'll ask the advisory board members to introduce themselves to the people here. Now, also, finally, as you've seen from the brochure, this conference is co-sponsored by the NYU Law Review, which is going to be publishing some of the papers that you hear presented today. And Maybelline Menahideka is here today, and I know she would like to say, the editor-in-chief of the Law Review, and I know she'd like to say a word or two, so I ask her to come up and do that, and then we'll come back and tell you a little bit more about the center, and then we can go right into the conference. Maybelline?
Good morning. My name is Maybelline Menahideka, and I'm the editor-in-chief of the NYU Law Review. The Law Review partnered up with the Center on Civil Justice to co-host this special symposium in honor of the 50th anniversary of Rule 23. When we were approached to co-host Rule 23 at 50, we enthusiastically agreed. We are honored to have this wonderful opportunity to collaborate with the Center. The Law Review special symposium issue will be published in October 2017, volume 92 of the Law Review. I want to personally thank all of the authors who are contributing pieces to our symposium issue. Many of them are here today. Professor Jeffrey Miller, Professor Judith Resnick, Professor Zachary Clofton, Professor Alexandra Lahab, Professor Robert Klonoff, Professor Pamela Bookman, Professor David Knoll, Professor Brooke Coleman, Professor Elizabeth Porter, Professor Scott Dodson, Professor Arthur Miller, and last but not least, Professor Samuel Isaacroff. I also want to thank the Center on Civil Justice for their collaborative partnership, and of course the members of the Law Review for all of their hard work. We hope you all enjoy the conference, and now I'll turn it back to Peter Zimroth. Thank you.
So I just saw Jeff Miller come in, and he's another one of the faculty co-directors, and I already introduced you to Sam, and Arthur is not here today, I mean, not here this minute, but I know he's going to be here, so you will have, you know who all of them are. Okay, so about the center. We've been in existence for about just 2 years. This is our third major conference. Our mission, the mission of the center is to conduct research and provide a forum for lawyers and judges, policymakers to discuss the very real problems that are confronting the civil justice system in the United States. We are not an advocacy organization, but we are very much action-oriented. In other words, we are bringing together lawyers and judges and other practitioners and policymakers to think about concrete solutions to the very real problems that confront the civil justice system. And we're focused a lot on empirical data that can help us understand what might work and what might not work to improve the lot of all those people in this country every day who depend upon the civil justice system for justice. Just to give you just a couple of quick examples, last year's conference was on third-party litigation funding. And out of that conference came a commitment to continue engagement in that new area. And so we are planning, for example, the creation of a document repository database to consolidate what is everybody understands is very hard to find resources in this new field. Another major project grew out of our very first conference on consumer class actions. So we're trying to collect as much data as possible on class actions and also on other kinds of mass resolutions and become a neutral repository for all this information, so that everybody interested in these areas will be able to access the data and make arguments about what they mean and what they don't mean. This is really data about things like the value of awards and settlements, the amount of attorney's fees, administrative costs, the size of classes, the response rates to certain, what kind of notices go out, the response rates to them, the success or failure of different methods of notice and different methods of payment, and et cetera, and et cetera, and et cetera. Because we think it's very important that discussion and argument about these very important civil justice issues and about the effectiveness of aggregate litigation and aggregate resolution be resolved by hard evidence and not on anecdote, and which is what we have all too much of right now. And we have also several other projects in the works, and I'm not going to mention them, but I would urge you to go to our website, which is Center on Civil Justice, one word, .org. And you can see the other work that we're doing, as well as who's on our advisory board and the rest of the leadership. So, about the conference itself, I don't need to say very much. You can look at the brochure. Breakfast will be served here. There's actually real food there, which you're welcome to have. And lunch as well. There'll be lunch. So what time? Lunch was like what time?
Around noon.
And that's basically it. So I want to turn it over to Troy, who has been on leave for a couple of years. Troy. Graduated from the law school, I think, in 2000, right? Do I get that right? He was a professor here. He's on leave. He clerked for Judge Pierre Laval, who is one of our advisory board members, and then for John Paul Stevens. He joined the NYU Law Faculty in 2007. Troy.
Great. Well, thank you, Peter. So this morning's panel, first panel up this morning, is a panel on Rule 23 with a focus on both some of the historical paths that the rule did take or could have taken, and on the current interpretation of Rule 23 and the receptiveness of courts, both the Supreme Court and lower courts, to arguments to limit or expand the scope of the class action device. We have three fantastic panelists this morning to start off our discussion. First will be Scott Dodson of Hastings. He is the Associate Dean for Research and the Hastings Research Chair at Hastings in San Francisco. Then we will hear from Bob Klonoff of Lewis and Clark Law School, former dean. And then we will hear comments on the papers presented by Professor Dodson and Professor Klonoff by Judge Dow of the Northern District of Illinois. So I think it's probably best if we jump in immediately. As moderator, I will use my prerogative to ask impertinent, annoying, and sometimes even ribald questions as I see fit and as the mood strikes me. So I will turn it over to Professor Dodson.
Okay, great. Well, thanks to the Center on Civil Justice and to NYU and the organizers here for putting on really a wonderful conference, and quite thrilled to be up here with the distinguished panelists and to see a lot of very familiar faces in the crowd. Been chosen to kick off the presentations, which is both flattering and quite frankly a little terrifying. And my remarks will focus on what I call a negative retrospective of Rule 23 over the years. Basically, the premise is to look at some of the amendment proposals to Rule 23 that were seriously considered but not adopted by the rulemakers. And in engaging this negative retrospective, I hope to shed some light on two issues. The first is, what were some of the choices made in designing the current Rule 23 such that we can compare it to what could have been? And then second, what has hindered rulemaking in the Rule 23 arena so that we can potentially draw some conclusions about class action rulemaking? And I want to make clear that my comments today are not meant to be normative. I aim to observe rather than criticize. And there are a couple of reasons for this. The first is that I have no wish to be thrown into a den of lions. I see a number of current and former advisory committees members here and back right next to me. And second, I just don't have enough time to do the normative issues the justice that they deserve. And a third reason is that I still haven't worked out all of them in my own head. So let me start with the history, and then I'll turn to some observations. And I slice it in different ways. There are obviously different ways to slice and dice the history, and maybe I'll talk a little bit about some of those choices that I've made in my remarks as well. So the first era that I deal with in the paper is the Rule 66, the 1966 Rule Amendment Package that produced the modern Rule 23. And this history is fairly well recounted, including by former advisory committee reporters, David Marcus, Ed Cooper, Arthur Miller, Benjamin Kaplan, and much ink has been spilled on sort of what was done, including the more adventuresome Rule 23b3 experiment and how it might apply to mass torts. But for my purposes, I've tried to focus on two key rejections that the committee made. The first is the rejection of Professor Chaffee's proposal to collapse the categories that previously existed into a single, unitary, highly discretionary standard that was modeled on a federal equity rule 38. And this proposal would have generated significant discretion among judges to basically craft a class action mechanism on a case-by-case basis to fit the class to the case. It also would have avoided the categorization problems that had plagued the 1930s version. Nevertheless, the advisory committee rejected the proposal. And Ben Kaplan later wrote the proposal would not have been especially helpfully informative and may have led courts to certify class actions only sporadically and in an ad hoc manner. And the committee ultimately voted against the proposal in part because it preferred clearer rule guidance over significant judicial discretion. The second key committee rejection in this area was the opt-in mechanism that had dominated the rule in the 1930s and that continues to be a mainstay of class action practice around the rest of the world. Kaplan later reflected the committee rejected this proposal because the opt-in mechanism had the propensity to freeze out the claims of people, especially small claims held by small people, who will simply not take the affirmative step to opt in. And the rationale here was a focus on the compensatory values of class actions. And it was relatively dismissive of defense side concerns and of concerns for protecting absent class members. So these two rejections from this era signaled a committee preference for greater use of classes and for rule-based guidance in certification decisions. Then there was a gap. The advisory committee did not consider Rule 23 amendments from 1966 to 1991, despite many calls to do so. The history of this period is fascinating and ably recounted by Steve Burbank, Bob, Judith Resnick, and others. And during this time, the court struggled to sort of bring Rule 23 into line with the changes that were happening with litigation practice, especially in mass tort and employment discrimination cases. The settlement class was one of these innovations that became into vogue in this era. But the second era of rulemaking that I want to deal with started in 1991, when the Judicial Conference formally asked the advisory committee to take a look at Rule 23 and inquire as to whether or not it was up to the challenges of then the modern litigation. The advisory committee did so, and its deliberations during this time were quite wide-ranging, comprehensive. But the result was that only one successful amendment came out. That was Rule 23F, interlocutory appeals of certification decisions. So I focus on two of the failed proposals from this era, the so-called just ain't worth it factor and the settlement certification proposal. The just ain't worth it factor was a proposed new Rule 23B3F, which would have added a requirement that the probable relief to the individual class members justifies the costs and burdens of class litigation. The rationale behind this was that without substantial compensation to the class members, then neither the compensatory goals nor the substantive regulatory deterrence goals of class actions were justified in light of their costs. The proposal was sort of spurred by the genesis of coupon settlements and the suspicion that a lot of class actions were being abused to the benefit of the class counsel rather than class claimants. The second significant amendment would have added a new certification authorization in B4 for settlement classes, even though the requirements of subdivision B3 might not be met for purposes of trial. Now, this proposal was meant to overturn a line of Third Circuit decisions that had basically held that certification had to be for purposes of trial, even if the class was never meant to be litigated. And the motivation for wanting to overturn this line was to ease the efficiency, to make class action settlement more efficient and to ease those kinds of resolutions, especially in the mass torts arena. The advisory committee ultimately abandoned these proposals, and I think there are two main reasons. First, the committee record suggests that the committee abandoned the proposals because of the voluminous public comments that were made in response to them, left them politically too hot to proceed, and it presented the concern that significant litigation would be generated over them had they become law. And second, I think the Supreme Court abandoned the B4 settlement certification proposal in part because the Supreme Court granted cert in a Third Circuit case on that issue, and the advisory committee held off at least until the court had issued its opinion. The court did, in what is what we now know and mostly love, AmChem, and then the advisory committee returned to the B4 proposal to see if that rulemaking was, in fact, warranted. It ultimately decided not to engage in any rulemaking after AmChem, even though it recognized that AmChem did not answer all of the questions, that AmChem's solution was somewhat different than before, and that AmChem left some questions for later resolution. And nevertheless, I think the advisory committee thought that it provided at least one possible workable solution to the settlement certification issue, and thought that it would wait until the lower courts had a chance to incorporate the Supreme Court's standard and see if it worked effectively. So the takeaway in this second era is that the advisory committee abandoned these efforts, at least in part because of the controversy that they generated and because the Supreme Court took the lead. In 2003, there were some successful amendments to Rule 23, including to subdivisions G, H, C, and E. These were mostly to the mechanics of class litigation after the class had been certified, rather than to certification standards in B and A. But in 2011, the advisory committee formed a Rule 23 subcommittee to determine if there was an opportunity for more fundamental rulemaking. And again, the subcommittee considered a wide range of proposals, one of which I will discuss here was ultimately abandoned. It was a proposal to deal with the so-called requirement of ascertainability. So in the last few years, a few circuits have read into the idea of a class action the need for the class to be ascertainable, the class members to be identifiable by either feasible or sometimes even objective means. The strong form of ascertainability would even require that class member affidavits would be insufficient to establish ascertainability. So this seemed to be of great interest to the committee, and in June 2015, subcommittee reached agreement that the strong form of ascertainability ought to be discouraged and set to work drafting a sketch. Mixed public reactions to the sketch, coupled with, I think, the nascence of the issue among the circuits, then convinced the subcommittee to put the rule proposal on hold to allow the issue to percolate, develop in the lower courts. And so it put ascertainability on hold. So what can we make of these amendment proposals that were not? Well, I think we might consider what Rule 23 might have looked like had history been a bit different. And putting the paradoxes of time travel to the side for the moment, a different course of history plausibly could have resulted in a Rule 23 with the following features: an opt-in mechanism either required or as an option under Rule 23b3, settlement certification standards that are significantly lighter than trial certification standards, more judicial discretion in certification generally and the erosion or relaxation of the formal categories in B, and certification consideration of the social and administrative costs of class actions. And I want to make two points here. The first is that I think these features, even taken in the aggregate, are not outside of the realm of reason. There have been serious and credible arguments for each of these proposals at a number of times over the history of the class action device. The opt-in option has resurfaced several times, as has certification, settlement certification issues. And the costs of class actions are a perennial bugaboo to class action discussions. So a civil justice system rationally could choose this kind of Rule 23 as its class action regime. And indeed, our own MDL system looks a little bit like this. But the second point is that while these features are within reason, they do depart dramatically from the current rule. The current rule attempts to offer, without prioritization, procedural efficiency, substantive regulatory deterrence, and claimant compensation. And although the housekeeping provisions grant some discretion to district judges, the certification provisions remain highly formalist, even in the face of the cost of class litigation and the compelling efficiencies of settlement. And the protection of absent class members through opt-out and notice mechanisms remain fairly minimal. So these two visions of Rule 23, whatever their relative virtues, I think are quite different. A couple of other things that I think we might glean from Rule 23's negative history, I'll just go through them very quickly. For one, I think the negative retrospective adds some dimension to Judith Resnick's claim that the history of class actions is intimately tied to the changing cultural and social norms. The 1960s elites saw the power of aggregation, and so tried to enhance class actions and expand upon them. By the 1990s, class actions, though ingrained in litigation, had generated a backlash, and so the 1990s committee considered proposals that would have reined in classes, controlled their costs, and tried to refocus them where they were most wanted. In today's age of judicial discretion, the current committee seems much more content to just let the common law development and judicial discretion take the lead. Another observation is that Rule 23's negative history, I think, reveals a trend away from rule-based prescriptions and towards more judicial discretion and common law development. By rejecting Professor Chaffee's proposal, the 1960s committee favored rule guidance over judicial discretion. The 1990s committee, however, would have re-injected judicial discretion into class certification decisions, particularly with settlement classes and in consideration of the costs of class actions. And then finally, I think the rejected amendments to Rule 23 confirm the ongoing and unresolved tension between the normative commitment of Rule 23. Is it for substantive regulatory deterrence values? Is it for claimant compensation? Is it a procedural efficiency device? These were issues that were lightly appreciated by the 1960s committee. It came to a head in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and were more fully debated in the 1990s, but left unresolved by amendment failure. And today, rightly or wrongly, I think the committee has a very little inclination to resolve that tension through rulemaking, so that at this point, it seems that Rule 23 will continue to serve somewhat disparate functions without much normative rule guidance. I'll stop there.
Great. Well, thank you. I will now turn it over to Bob Klonoff.
Thank you. It's a real honor to be here today, and I want to thank the organizers of this great conference. I wrote an article in 2013 for the Washington University Law Review called The Decline of Class Actions. And my thesis was that the Supreme Court and many of the federal circuits were on almost a mission to cut back on class actions. It almost seemed as if there was an agenda. And I'll speak to my evidence of that in a minute. And there was a common theme in many of the cases, which was an assumption that many, if not most, class actions were meritless, and that there was what the courts called blackmail pressure on defendants to settle meritless cases. And this concern really led to what I argued was a deliberate effort across many areas of class action law to cut back on the ability to bring class actions. Well, here I am now in 2016, and my article is called Class Actions Part 2, A Respite from the Decline. And for those of you who think class actions are a good thing, or at least can be a good thing, I'm here to present some good news. I'm not sure, given the election, how long the good news will last. But I do think it's striking, and I want to really talk about Again, a series of developments that I think together suggest that something very different is going on today than was going on in 2013. And let me just very quickly summarize why I think this is happening, and then I'll get into the details of what is actually happening. Justice Scalia's death, I think, is a part of the dynamic here, but as I'm going to explain, it's only a small part of it, and actually a lot of the developments that I talk about predated Justice Scalia's death. I think that there's what I call judicial fatigue. I think in the Supreme Court in particular, the court seems to be tired of pronouncing major class action decisions. I mentioned in the article that we saw a similar scenario in the context of punitive damages, where there were a flurry of cases leading up to the Campbell decision in 2003, and then all of a sudden there was virtually nothing, and there have only been one or two punitive damage decisions since then. So some of that may be going on as well. What I think the main thing that's happening is, and I'll develop that this morning, is I think that the defense bar, rather than working in a more nuanced and deliberative fashion, have really shot too far trying to really cut back class actions altogether and have really engaged in overly aggressive advocacy and have been shot down repeatedly by the courts for that. And I think the courts are now issuing some pushback. And I'll talk about the amicus strategy of the Chamber of Commerce in particular in just a moment. So what we're seeing in this recent trend is a return to courts doing what I think they should be doing, and that's deciding cases on the law and on the facts and really dealing with the issue at hand as opposed to trying to sweep away class actions in some broad fashion. So let me first briefly talk about what is my evidence that there was an agenda going on. First, in terms of the Supreme Court, obviously you had a number of very important decisions. You had in just a few years three major decisions dealing with arbitration. And I would suggest that's probably the most dramatic impact in terms of cutting back on class action. But to have the court taking three cases in such a short period of time is significant. I also think it's significant in both Comcast and Dukes, and I lay this out in the article, the extent to which the court rewrote the issues for the parties. Comcast was a particular mess. I mean, the court rewrote the issue once, and then it turned out at argument that even that issue didn't work because of the arguments that were actually made. You would think the court would have dismissed the case as improvidently granted, but they went ahead and decided the case. Again, was to me evidence that the court really wanted to address class actions there. Contrast that to the recent developments in a couple cases where the court has dismissed as improvidently granted cases where the lawyers argued one point in their cert petition and then changed their arguments at the merits, and they were recently bounced. So I think that those are important developments. In Dukes, where the court added an issue dealing with commonality, that wasn't even raised by Walmart as a ground for certiorari. So you see this active court, you know, reframing the issues. I thought that was very, very important. And then again, the repeated emphasis in these cases, a major part of Concepcion is this blackmail pressure to settle meritless cases, a theme that now has really, as I point out in my paper, disappeared from the jurisprudence. You don't see that in any of the recent Supreme Court or circuit cases. That's just gone, and I'm going to tie that back to what I think is the overly aggressive advocacy. And then I saw at least, evidence of this agenda, this flurry of cert grants in Tyson Foods, Spokio, and Campbell Ewald, and I thought, here we go. This is going to be proof positive that what I said in 2013 is absolutely true, and in fact, it ended up totally undercutting my theory because all three of those decisions were really quite underwhelming. At the circuit level, and I think this is probably the most important thing that I brought in the Wash U article, everyone was talking about the Supreme Court, but I spent a lot of time talking about all these disparate strands of circuit law, and they all had this common theme, front-loading of evidence, ascertainability, class definition, numerosity, all these categories, the courts were cutting back substantially on class actions, and I argued that they were all a part of a common trend. So let me talk about now what's going on and what makes me think that there is actually a respite. Most law scholars don't spend a lot of time analyzing cert denieds. But I actually think this recent spate of cert denieds and class actions is profoundly important. And I want to just mention five recent cases that were denied. And I actually thought several of these were going to be granted. First was the Sears case from the Seventh Circuit, the moldy washing machine case. Really an aggressive pro-plaintiff approach dealing with consumer class actions. A similar case from the Sixth Circuit, the Whirlpool case. The Mullins case, which dealt with ascertainability, and the Mullins, the Seventh Circuit, was absolutely clear that it was creating a conflict among the circuits. So it was really teed up for Supreme Court review, very important issue, no one could deny that. The RICO's case from the Sixth Circuit, also dealing with a number of basic class action issues, and then the Avandia Glasgow Smith Klein case, a RICO class action. There's one fact that ties all these cases together that one might use to explain it, and that's that the plaintiff lawyer in all of these cases was Sam Zakharoff, and that he just did a brilliant job of briefing the cases.
No, that can't be right.
And I really think there's a lot more going on there. In fact, my observation from my time in the Solicitor General's office was that the court actually is more inclined to grant cert when there are good lawyers on both sides. So I think Sam's involvement, notwithstanding the great job that he did in opposing cert, that might have actually made it more likely that they would want to take, for example, an ascertainability where they would have world-class representation on both sides. And there's something really interesting about all of these cases, because all of these cases had an army of amicus briefs in support of cert, led by the Chamber of Commerce. And in every one of these cases, the Chamber said, this case is catastrophic for business. You have to grant class cert. And then they invoked the blackmail pressure to settle. And the court wasn't listening. It no longer resonated, and it no longer resonated even with Plaque and the Washington Legal Foundation and the National Association of Manufacturers, all these amicus briefs that in the past had been so persuasive in convincing the court that the cases were important. Really had very, very little impact. Obviously, the court denying these cases. The Whirlpool case is especially interesting, and I make note of that. And I think it's going to do long-term damage to the credibility of the defense, in that after saying, this is blackmail pressure to settle a meritless case, we're going to have to pay a huge settlement, we're not going to go to trial. They actually went to trial. In the Whirlpool case after cert was denied and the defense won. So this notion that they're forced to settle every case simply isn't panning out. So the second category of evidence, and I know my time is limited, but Tyson Food, Campbell Ewald, and Spokio were all surprising and very, very narrow decisions. And in fact, Tyson Food and Campbell Ewald ended up being pro-plaintiff decisions. And in Tyson Food, the court was very, very critical of the defense argument and basically trying to eliminate all statistical evidence, essentially what I'm saying, the overly aggressive advocacy. You also have the Amgen decision, which really is very strong pushback to this tendency of the circuits to front-load evidence. And Amgen is being relied on now extensively in the circuits and in the district courts. And then finally, you see the circuits in a whole bunch of areas retreating and really not being as aggressive. Their interpretations in the recent cases of Amgen, Spokio, Tyson Food and Campbell Ewald, very measured, not pushing the envelope. The circuits have rejected broad arguments for applying Comcast, have rejected the argument that individualized damages defeats class certification. Duke's hasn't had at all the impact that I thought it would. Courts have been, for the most part, distinguishing the case. It has had some impact, but not a revolutionary impact. Ascertainability hasn't caught on, and even the Third Circuit has cut back. And I note in particular the Byrd case, which ties into my general theme, where the Third Circuit really went out of its way to criticize defendants for overly aggressive advocacy and for misapplying the ascertainability standard. I mentioned the consumer class actions, and even in the arbitration area, we're seeing some recent circuit cases in the employment area giving pushback to Concepcion and the Supreme Court's other cases. So I think all of this taken together suggests that we're in a very, very different period right now than we were in 2013.
Great, thank you. I now turn it over to Judge Dow for comments on both papers.
Great. Well, thank you, everybody. As I said to Peter when I came in, I kind of feel like a kid in a candy store on a day like today because it's all very intellectual and stimulating. And yesterday, I think I had 20 statuses, 2 roles to show cause, 2 guilty pleas, which I now can do in my sleep, and a revocation of supervised release. That's not, none of that's very intellectual. It's all important, but it's not very intellectual. So thank you for having me. I really enjoyed reading both of the papers. I know Professor Marcus told me that I may not agree with everything that Professor Dodson said, but I actually found myself agreeing with a lot of the article, and some of the article also was new, sort of filling in a lot of blanks for me. I've spent a lot of time with Professor Cooper and Professor Marcus in the last few years working on the subcommittee. There's a lot of things they talk about amongst themselves, and I think Bob understands all this when they talk about what happened in 1983 and what happened in 1991, and they sort of forget that I was in high school in 1983. I learned a lot from reading Professor Dodson's article, a lot of things that I sort of vaguely heard about from past history, and I appreciate the blank filling in. There's also a bit of back to the future, and every time the advisory committee appoints a subcommittee to look at an important issue like Rule 23. So what I saw is that this is not the first time that the subcommittee's thought about a lot of the things that we're thinking about now. 23B4 is something that, you know, there was a trial run 20 plus years ago, and we went through that again, that same exercise the last 3 years, and decided that there isn't a need, at least in our minds, for a 23B4 today either. The just ain't worth it, I really enjoyed reading, and as someone who practiced in the Seventh Circuit for 12 and a half years before I became a judge underneath the thumb of the Seventh Circuit, the just ain't worth it, and some of the things that Professor Klonoff talked about as well, the blackmail pressure. I mean, my first year of practice at Mayor Brown, working for defendants pretty much all the time, Roan Poulenc came out. And Roan Poulenc is, at least in my history, the beginning of the blackmail pressure case law. And there are still echoes of just ain't worth it in a lot of the things that we've looked at in the last 3 years in the subcommittee. There's a push from the defense bar to look seriously at no injury classes and create some sort of rule of that nature. I think in ascertainability also there is some whiff of just ain't worth it in there. And there's certainly in my circuit, if you read all of Judge Posner's cases for the last few years, which I read very carefully because I don't want a backboard broken on my head, as some of my colleagues have unfortunately felt, there's some just ain't worth it in his opinions as well. So it's interesting to see how every 10 or 20 years, whether we need it or not, sometimes we go back and look at the same issues over and over again to try to figure out whether, if not then, why not now? And we've done that on the subcommittee. I think one of the fair points that Professor Dodson points out, at least amongst for the Rule 23 proposals that are currently out for public comment, we have been conservative in what we're pushing. About 5 weeks ago, the FJC came out to South Bend and put on a workshop for the judges in the Seventh Circuit. And one of the presenters there was Professor Tidmarsh from Notre Dame, and he gave an excellent talk on current developments in Rule 23, a lot like what Professor Klonoff just spoke about. And he also pointed out what the advisory committee is doing and not doing, very sort of similar to Professor Dodson's paper, only this was just a look at today's subcommittee and today's rule proposals. And he pointed out that as to a number of things, cypre, ascertainability, pickoff maneuvers, issue classes that the subcommittee punted, and he kept saying then the subcommittee punted. And after about the third of those, one of the judges from Indiana raised her hand and said to Professor Tidmarsh, "Why do you think the subcommittee punted on all these things?" And of course, I don't think he has any idea that I was the chair of the subcommittee. So I raised my hand and I said, "Well, as the punter in chief, let me offer you a few observations on why each of these issues we decided not to propose a rule change." And for each of them, there's actually a different reason. There isn't an institutional reluctance to wade into controversial areas. And Professor Marcus pretty much takes down every word of what we discuss in our subcommittee meetings, and we've had more of them than I can count in the last 3 years. But there's a different reason for each of those areas in which we've decided not to go into. And I think if you look at, if you think about proportionality, and that's an issue that generated a tremendous amount of interest and a tremendous amount of controversy, I don't think that the advisory committee is reflexively opposed to wading into controversial areas. But in the class action area, after careful deliberation, and our subcommittee is represented with plaintiffs' lawyers, defense lawyers, academics, reporters who've been doing this for a long, long, long time, and then the full advisory committee, of course, weighs in on this as well. And we've gone to every bar association that would have us and every group of professors that would have us to try to figure out if we're focused on the right things. But I think at the end of the day, for this round of Rule 23 proposed reforms, Professor Dodson has us pegged. I mean, it is incremental. It's in large part a codification of existing practices. And we go to rooms like this, full of excellent professors, and to the extent there are practitioners here, they are the top of the profession. And we had a mini conference in Dallas where we went over all the proposals, and we shelved some of them, we refined others. But some of the commentary we had is, well, why do you need this? Because we already do all this. And the fact of the matter is, if you just sit in my courtroom for a month, you'll realize everybody doesn't do this. The most excellent practitioners already give us all that we need for front loading. They anticipate all the potential issues that may come up when Judge Posner reviews my work. But not everybody does that, and I do think there's a value to codifying the best practices, not only for practitioners, but also for judges. Because not every judge comes to this fully formed in civil litigation either, and understanding Rule 23 and having a lot of experience in Rule 23. So in some ways, I agree with Professor Dodson's characterization that sometimes the advisory committees do rulemaking small ball, and I think people might say that's what we're doing here. But I do think it's the small ball that we're doing is very important. The one area in which we have done something that's that was also looked at before by the appellate committee, but not by the civil committee as much as this objector problem. And I see an objector problem as a district judge in that they lay low and say nothing. And part of the rule change that we're proposing is that you have to state your objections with specificity. Because there's nothing more frustrating than reading an appellate brief saying I missed something that wasn't even raised. And that's what's going on here. And also, the idea of trying to put the bad objector business model out of business is not a bad one. Of course, there are good objectors, and if you're in my circuit and you read Judge Posner's opinions, you realize how much value Judge Posner sees in the good objectors. But I think that for what we're doing today, and I did this in South Bend as well, I feel perfectly comfortable standing on the proposals we have, even though I agree that we could have been bolder. If I turn to Professor Klonoff's article for a minute, so when I first, in 2013, I was in the Appellate Rules Committee, and I had a call from Judge Sutton and Judge Campbell saying, hey, would you mind if we switched you over to civil? And we're going to switch you over to civil. We also want you to take on to be the chair of the Rule 23 subcommittee. Now, at that point, for 6 years, I'd been a district judge, and the only time I thought about class actions was when someone shoved a piece of paper under my nose and asked me to sign it and to approve their settlement. Very rarely did I actually have a litigated motion for class certification. At Mayor Brown, I did class action work, but it had been a while since I had done it. And what they told me is, and to get up to speed, read this article by Bob Klonoff. And so that was sort of my reintegration into class actions hook, line, and sinker, which is what I've done for the last 3 years. I feel like I could give a Rule 23 talk in my sleep, and I usually give one at least once a week. But I think it's been really helpful for the subcommittee, because we've all been out on this listening tour, whatever you want to call it, to get a lot of input. But Bob Klonoff's article from 2013, which is the jumping off point for his talk today, is the jumping off point for my re-immersion into class action law. And I think at the end of the day, I agree with everything that's in the article in terms of where we're headed. It was a bit startling for me to read the article in 2013 because I just knew what was in front of me, really. I have 400 cases right now. I had not done a lot of trial work before I became a trial judge. I was swimming as fast as I could to get up to speed, and I didn't have a lot of time to read law review articles. I read a lot of them now, especially in this area. But I think what's interesting about this, and this is Bob's conclusion of his article, I don't know how many of you had a chance to read it, but the conclusion of his article is that, like the Supreme Court's Amgen opinion in its 2015 term decisions, recent circuit cases, for the most part, are cautious, narrow, and generally unreceptive to defendants' requests to impose sweeping new limits on class actions. And I think if there's ever an epitaph written for the last round of what the subcommittee of the advisory committee did, that would be a very accurate description of what we've done as well. And I think it's the right decision. I actually think it's the right decision for the Supreme Court and the circuits, as if they really care about my opinion, because I work for them, they don't work for me. I think that's what we've done as well. And I think from my perspective in class action law, that's a pretty comfortable place, because I think in my day-to-day practice, Rule 23 works pretty well when the lawyers do their jobs and the judge does their job. And part of what we're trying to do with the rules proposals is to help the lawyers do their jobs better and the judges do their jobs better. And it's also very consistent with the 2015 amendments to the Rules of Civil Procedure. One of the main principles is early and active judicial case management. And I think that's what front-loading is trying to do in the Rule 23 area, is to get judges involved earlier with better information so that they can shape class action settlements, which is, for the most part, where class actions end up. And in my experience, at least, a lot of the cases that come to me under Rule 23, I'm the only objector who's out there. And I'm the one who has to look after the interest of the absent class members, because a lot of people come in and say, we both agree, this is a great deal. And then I look at them like, wow, that's a big payment to the named plaintiff. Give me an explanation for why that's justified. And I think the more information judges are encouraged to demand and receive, the better job we can all do in making Rule 23 live up to its potential.
Great. Well, thank you. So I will start off with a couple questions for Scott Dodson. Your paper is interesting because it focuses on these eras, and I think you're absolutely right about the main eras to focus our attention on, but there's this huge gap between 66 and 1991. So one question for you is, was nothing going on at that time? Was it simply kind of a medieval period where things were happening but they weren't really of importance more broadly? Or was it an era where the class action was actually working really, really well and there was just no need for the committee to get involved?
Yeah, so I think this is documented by others pretty effectively. It was a time of some tumult in the litigation world. The 66 Rule 23 version was being experimented with at the same time that there was a dramatic increase in federal litigation and an interest in mass torts. And so some have called it sort of a self-imposed moratorium that the committee had on Rule 23 considerations. There were movements afoot to try to get the committee to look at Rule 23 during this era. Congress took a look, the executive branch tried to get involved. Those efforts all failed, but the committee itself, I think, took a very hands-off approach to see what was going on. There was a lot going on, but not within the committee, I think, at that time, which is why I don't deal with it in great detail in the paper.
And for Bob Klonoff, one of the things you said which really struck me as being a significant observation is the decline of the rhetoric of the blackmail settlement, not so much in the Supreme Court, but definitely in the lower courts. Why do you think that rhetoric has softened in the last few years? Do you think it's just maybe a statistical blip, or do you think there's something that has altered the judicial mind about that concept, which actually I think dates back before Roan Polonk. It goes all the way back to Judge Friendly in the early 70s.
Well, one thing that's happened that's dramatic is a lot more class actions are going to trial, and I document that in a recent article I published in the Emory Law Journal. Very surprising when I really dug into it. When I did the first edition of my casebook in 1998, I had a hard time finding more than a handful of class actions that actually went to trial. And that situation has really changed. You pick up the paper, they're constantly big bet the company class actions going to trial now. Why is that? Well, one reason I think is the courts led by the Seventh Circuit have made it much more difficult to settle class actions with coupon settlements and with the sort of collusive settlements that we saw in the past. And so now defendants might as well roll the dice and go to trial. But I think that's a big difference. I also think that when you keep hearing it again and again in every case, it gets old. And I think that was the problem with the chamber. The chamber came in. RICO's was a great example, the Sixth Circuit case I mentioned, where they acknowledged that this case was an outlier. But then they said, nonetheless, there's a blackmail pressure to settle meritless cases. It just got really old. And I footnote a couple of brand new district court decisions that really support. I was trying to see. You can't draw much from the absence. You know, I couldn't find it in the recent Supreme Court cases, and I only found one recent circuit case that even mentioned blackmail. But I found these district court cases that affirmatively attacked the defense lawyers, and one of them said, this is the ultimate in hyperbole. And another said, if the blackmail pressure to settlement was a factor, then you could never have a class action. And I think people are just catching on now in a way they hadn't in the past, that it really doesn't advance the argument to say there's a blackmail pressure to settle. So it's dropped out, and I think that's a really significant point.
So on a related question, at the Supreme Court, you know, if you're, say, the chamber or an amicus that typically is allied with the chamber trying to get cert granted, what do you think is the next step if the strategy of filing lots of amicus briefs urging the court to take a case because this is, you know, it's an extremely important class action case for business, what do you think the next step strategically will be on that level?
Well, it's a great question, and I've really thought about it. As I mentioned in the article, the chamber's strategy is deliberate. In 2010, they made a conscious decision to ramp up their amicus strategy and file amicus briefs in way more cases. I would suggest they go to the Solicitor General model of coming in fewer cases, and they're going to have a lot more credibility. So don't file an amicus brief in a case like RICO's. If there are five class actions before the court, come in on one and say, we didn't come in on the other four, but this one really is important to business. So I think that they will do more by doing less. That would be my suggestion to the chamber, to PLAC, to all of these organizations. And I just think the courts are getting tired of every cert petition getting 8 or 9 amicus briefs in support of cert. So I think they should just stop doing that so much.
Well, I think that's a terrible idea because I want my students to have jobs. And I believe amicus briefs are full employment for bright young lawyers. And so I urge more amicus briefs, longer amicus briefs.
Well, and the interesting thing about it is it's a one-way process. You're not going to have 7 amicus briefs in opposition to certiorari. Right. That kind of undercuts the notion that the case isn't important.
So I think at this point we can open it up for questions from the floor. And I see Sam has his hand up. There are microphones on either side.
So I have a question for Judge Dow. We're always trying to find dualities, right? So we have B2 versus B3. We have settlement classes versus litigation classes. And I think I'm starting to see a new duality develop in class action practice. And I'd like to hear whether you've had any thoughts about it or any reactions to it. And that is, we're seeing the rise of a different kind of class from the idea of representative litigation. It always was a named plaintiff with counsel, and counsel's really doing all the work, and the rest of the class is completely passive. But we have cases like NFL, where they're not passive. You know, they were almost selected for the profession by not being passive. And we have cases like VW, where we just released the first settlement administrator's report, and within a couple of weeks of settlement, 470,000 people have been registered and engaged and begun the process. So there's an idea that social media, whatever the mechanism is, has created the participatory class action. That is where there's a different set of concerns than there were of the runaway class lawyer, the rational passivity that the court discussed in Amchem. And now all of a sudden you have a highly visible, highly monitored judicial process with lots of participants, oftentimes with lots of independent lawyers coming in. Do you think that's a trend, and do you think that that shakes up a little bit of the thinking of the committee, where the rules are always designed to cabin the discretion of counsel because of the agency cost problem and the idea that they're going to be runaway figures?
Well, I think that those are examples of class actions that should make people feel good about Rule 23 in the class action process, because I do think, and this is obviously, if you read Judge Posner's decision, there's a lot of what his concern is all these absent class members are just they're led around by the nose by lawyers who want to make a lot of money. And I think the VW case is a perfect example of a case that ought to make people feel good about the system, because it was extremely efficiently done. It got relief to people who really needed it fast. It took care of an environmental problem as well. And it is very efficient. And I think the more cases we have like that that are in the public eye and people can see, I think the more people will understand the good parts of Rule 23, because I think too often what people see in the paper is the coupon settlement or the ridiculous sum of money that's paid for something that doesn't look to the public like an important problem, or the fact that the average person gets, my father-in-law has a check for 18 cents that he's gotten a class action, and he framed it and put it in his bathroom. I think that's a statement of social commentary for all of his grandchildren who come in and use that bathroom. But I think cases like that, where it's true participatory class actions that get a lot of media attention, I think are good for all of us in the profession, because they were done really well. And I wish there were more cases like that. But Rule 23 also creates a vehicle for aggregation of claims where the plaintiffs can't be found. And that's part of the notice proposal that we have goes to this. And as you point out, Sam, that social media is a revolutionary thing. My kids don't understand what it was like even 20 years ago when you couldn't Twitter anybody and you wanted to invite someone to lunch, you actually wrote them a note. You didn't just tweet them or message them or whatever. But I think that to the extent people can follow that example, it looks really good for all of us. And I do see more of that, and I agree with you that the more people you can get in touch with right away, instantaneously, and tell them this is your problem and we're here to help you, and they can participate, the better it is.
Hi. You mentioned, or at least a couple of times, the arbitration decisions that came down. And I'm wondering how you've thought about the relationship between the enforceability of arbitration, class waivers, and arbitration provisions. How's that affected the thinking of the drafters on the committee with respect to the availability of class actions, and whether or not that's taken a lot of pressure off of, in some sense, the kind of Chamber of Commerce concern about class actions generally?
Any thoughts on that?
We've certainly talked about those decisions. I can't really say that they were a driving force of really much of anything that we've done consciously. I mean, certainly that's taken some of the pressure, you would think, off the chamber, but I guarantee you come the new legislative session, we're going to be seeing a revival of the no injury statute and all those kinds of proposals. I just don't think it was...
It never hit the top of our agenda, or even the middle of it, I would say.
No.
Jeff Miller?
So, very interesting, from 2013 to today, Bob, where the Supreme Court and other courts seem to be gunning for class actions, and now they're holding their fire. So why are they doing that? And you came up with some ideas that are interesting. I'd like to put a conjecture out, which is a little different, which is, this is a dramatic change if it's happening. Why is it happening now? And I think possibly the reason it's happening is that the Supreme Court is actually changing their agenda, and the Chamber of Commerce is changing their agenda. The concern for the past 20, 30 years has been that class actions are oppressing industry, that big business is suffering, that we're not having efficient ways of producing things because of fear of liability. Today, after the financial crisis, the concern has changed very dramatically to the administrative state and the huge fines that are being levied against big business. So you have over $100 billion of fines against banks and other businesses in the past 5 years. And I believe that the Supreme Court is resetting its agenda, and there's a lot of sort of suggestions about that in some of the Supreme Court's opinions, to taking on the administrative state as opposed to taking on the plaintiff's attorneys, and that this backing off might reflect not so much an ennui about class actions, but the development of a new concern, both at the Chamber of Commerce and in the Supreme Court. So just like your thoughts about that.
There may be some merit to that in terms of explaining what the Supreme Court is doing. I mean, I think the evidence in terms of the chamber is exactly the opposite. I mean, my point is that they're coming in more cases now, more aggressively than ever in these class actions. They're basically supporting cert in every class action where the defendant has lost below.
Yeah, I agree, but look at what they're doing in the administrative state side. And there they've escalated the rhetoric dramatically. So while they haven't given up on the things they've been saying, in a way it might just be kind of a rote repetition of things they've been saying for a long time, as opposed to something new. So anyway, just—
No, interesting thought, thank you.
So, and I think further to Jeff's point, the recent discomfort with Chevron in judicial decisions at the Supreme Court and also in the courts of appeals might actually go along with that. With that thesis.
The other just comment that I would make is that also I don't think explains what's happening in the circuits either, and there's something going on there as well, I think. But I think it's an important insight. I'm just not sure it covers the whole scenario.
I had a number of suggestions, Scott. Excuse me. One is the possibility that the committee, and particularly Kaplan, was not interested in Chafee's proposal, because the one thing we know that a majority of the committee, and even John Frank eventually, were intent to do in the 60s was to animate the civil rights class action. And the Chafee proposal would not have accomplished that. Remember, Frank tried to get the committee to not do either B2, he gave that one up, or B3, and he didn't give that up. He kept coming back at it. Indeed, another point that you might want to take account of is that in, I think it was April of 1965, there was a vote on opt-in, and it lost 6-5. 6-5. I don't think most people are aware of how much opposition there was on the 1960s committee. It isn't true that the committee was inactive on class actions between 1966 and 1991. They spent 6 to 7 years in the 1970s studying class actions. And the fact that they started it, that it was the first thing that they started to do when the committee was reconstituted in 1971, is very good evidence of the tumult, as you put it, that the new rule was already clearly causing, particularly in Truth in Lending Act cases. They gave up that effort primarily because of the Justice Department proposal, to which I think you alluded, and their concern that that proposal brought clear light on the Enabling Act problems that any substantial amendments to Rule 23 would involve. Finally, in terms of comments, I get a little worried when I hear you talk about a Rule 23 in terms of its regulatory agenda. Rule 23 does not have and cannot have a regulatory agenda. It would be invalid under the Enabling Act. What it can do, and what Kaplan thought it could do, was facilitate the enforcement of regulatory policy found in legitimate sources of law, namely statutes and other rules of law. And if there's any doubt in your mind about that, just look at the way Kaplan treated preclusion. It was exactly in that way. We cannot state rules of preclusion, but we can provide procedural opportunities for their implementation. Bob, your comments on amicus briefs. We, in a new paper that Sean Farang and I have, we have a lot of data that supports what you're saying. In the group of cases that we're looking at, there's a huge increase. And I think it starts around 2000, maybe a little bit later than that, on the part of the chamber and the defense groups from 60 to 2000 or so in the 10 class actions that are in our data. It's limited because it's private enforcement class actions. They filed 2 amicus briefs, all of them. That's 20 cases. In 10 cases, they filed 7. So there was a huge increase in their amicus activity, and I agree with you that they kept singing the same song, and it had less and less resonance for the justices.
Well, and in 2010, they post on their website this dramatic new strategy of hiring Bush administration alums and, you know, dramatically ramping up their amicus briefing. I mean, so they deliberately did it, and I think that's not a very good message to send to courts, that we're now going to come in on every case where the business community asks us to file amicus briefs. So I'm glad to hear that my observations were supported.
I think I saw Judith Resnick's hand go up over there.
Hi. Ben Kaplan's papers have been recently archived at Harvard. So they're now available through the special collections to read, in addition to the sort of microfiche of the Congressional Information Service. And in that, one sees that discretion was a leitmotif for them, and there's a line, if I remember it right, about him saying, I want the judge on the firing line, his term, to be able to make all sorts of decisions. So I think that this negative history is a fabulous idea, but that there's a leitmotif throughout it of authorizing judges, which gets me to Judge Dow's comments about the question about regulation. From my lights, your new proposals, although they're great to be more directive, are still under-regulatory in terms of the needs for understanding both the more about the settlement and more about the settlement's implementation. And I guess I'd like the commentary, including the role of the Supreme Court, in this question. The Supreme Court seemed to have remarkably little appetite for trying to help judges figure out how to deal with class actions, and more in terms of either precluding them or constraining them in some way. Even Tyson isn't very helpful in directing. So I just would ask for your views, the four of you, on what role you see for rulemaking in helping to direct judicial discretion, which I think where I think Rule 23 has a huge amount of it inside it.
I'll just say to your last point, I think the Supreme Court did try to at least give some clues to how lower courts could exercise some discretion in the mechanics of class actions in Ortiz and AmCam, suggesting, you know, subclasses or issue classes for those particular cases. But in later cases, I think you're right that it's tended to make broad pronouncements, not remand cases, and give less guidance to lower courts as to what they were supposed to be doing.
I would say in our proposals, I mean, admittedly, it's incremental. An early draft of what we had in the front-loading proposal had what people criticized as the laundry list. And the laundry list would have been quite a bit more specific about what counsel must provide to the district judge with a motion for what everybody calls preliminary approval. We're trying to call that permission to give notice to the class. But and the laundry list essentially has been moved into the committee notes. But I think we're moving in that direction, and I think the idea is. Of course, the district judge has to exercise discretion at some point in this process, and what we're trying to do is encourage practitioners to provide the right information so the district judge can make a determination that is educated. There's no laundry list of absolute requirements. It's not like a checklist. That's certainly not what we're doing.
But I do think a good example of guiding discretion is in our proposal for the criteria for evaluating the fairness of settlements, where we've taken the variety of circuit factors. Some circuits have 10 factors, some have 12, some have 7, and we've tried to highlight for judges what are the core factors. So I think that is the kind of thing that you're talking about.
But wasn't it though that the committee was not attempting to change any circuit law in articulating those factors, but rather just trying to synthesize it?
Well, I think we're hoping that ultimately all the circuits will coalesce around the factors that we highlight. And we specifically note some factors that circuits rely on that we don't think are that important. For example, some circuits rely on whether or not counsel support the settlement. Well, they always support the settlement. So that shouldn't be given any weight at all. The Ninth Circuit relies on whether or not there's a government advocate supporting the settlement. That might be relevant in a case like Volkswagen, but there are many, many settlements where the government isn't involved, and that shouldn't be a consideration. So, yes, we say that ultimately each circuit law controls, but we're hoping that what these proposed rules are going to do is to tighten and provide more uniformity and get rid of some of these factors that we think don't really matter.
So I think we have time for one more question. Teddy Ray.
So my question is for Professor Dodson. I love this idea of the Rule 23 that could have been, but I wonder how much some of the features of it dramatically depart from the actual Rule 23 that we have, at least on the ground. So like the idea that it could be easier to certify a settlement class than a litigation class. I mean, if you look at like the De Beers antitrust settlement or the BP settlement, or I guess to some degree the NFL or VW settlements, I'm not sure that we could have certified those as litigation classes, but courts have certified them as settlement classes. Or the idea that at the certification stage, courts should consider the social or administrative costs of the class action. If you look at cases like the Aquedots case out of the Seventh Circuit, where the court decided not to certify a class because the defendant had set up a voluntary compensation program, and it just wouldn't be worth it in light of the fact that the plaintiffs were already getting compensation. Or, I guess to some extent, the TransUnion case, where actually the court did certify a settlement class that would preclude class members from bringing class actions in the future. That might be disturbing, but the court says, well, because this is the kind of typical blackmail settlement situation where you have statutory damages that aren't tied to the underlying harm, this actually looks like it's closer to the deterrence that we're looking for, and class members can get compensation. So I wonder, you know, is the rule so different from these proposals that were rejected?
Yeah, no, I think that's a good point. The difference, I think, is in what Rule 23 seems to say in the abstract and how it's applied by the lower courts in certain instances, and surely there are going to be district judges and some circuit judges that say, well, Rule 23 gives me substantial discretion and this is the right result. The result looks a lot like what the negative Rule 23 might have contemplated in specific cases. So that's a good point.
So I'd like to end by just pointing out that the reason why there's an empty space at the end of this table is that that's where Judge Posner's spirit is, and he has been watching over all of us. And
some of us more closely than others.
Some of us more closely than others, and silently commenting with approval on our survey of the history and current practice of Rule 23. So I'd like you to join me in thanking our panelists.